at you go.
Right?
Look at you go.
Well, you know, the thing is, I made so many mistakes.
Started from the bottom, and now you're here, you know?
Okay, first, we've got Rory McKernan here. The most handsome man in all of CrossFit. I get told and over again, the most handsome man in all of CrossFit.
Nice of you to say so.
Well, you know, the term I generally hear is the most classically handsome. I think there's others who offer like a unique level of handsomeness. Uh-huh. But
sexy.
Yes, yeah. Yes. But you have the most classic level of handsomeness.
Like a take you home to mom kind of look?
Yeah.
Yeah, thanks,
man. Yes, that's a good one. So, Rory, why don't you tell us your exact job title within CrossFit? I think
it's rolling through. That is a fantastic question, and I will tell you that in all my years, which is almost a decade now with CrossFit, the only official title that I've ever held is head trainer.
See?
Yeah, dude.
See?
We could surf steamer.
But there's too many people.
Okay,
let's go.
Yep.
Because if it's hitting steamers, it's going to hit.
Oh, we're going to have so much fun.
Yes. Okay.
I literally have no job title. What you could consider my job to be is creative direction for studio and broadcast efforts for the CrossFit Games, and obviously on camera host for our live broadcast.
Okay.
Which is my fun job.
Yeah.
That's the job I like.
Okay.
So creating in terms of what the graphics package is going to look like, I have a hand in that, but usually when it comes to, hey, we're going to do a live broadcast, whether it be on ESPN or our own channels, we want to make sure that it's not just about the top athletes, but we also get the message in there about, hey, everyone can do this. Here's what CrossFit's about. Here's how it's changing lives. So the whiteboard animations that we did years ago are one of the best examples of, hey, these guys are doing the burden run and they're lifting heavy stuff and it's truly amazing, but here's why they're doing it. It's a program that's affected millions of lives for people who aren't beastly crazy genetic freaks.
And I've actually, that's awesome. And so you're the guy who's kind of responsible for directing how that message gets put out.
I get to drive a lot of that, yep.
Awesome. And I think I've really seen personally a shift in how that has been done in the last, I'd say, year.
Yeah.
Where you guys, it looks like you're really trying to make a push there, which I think spectacular, because it truly is the best part of our program, right?
Yeah, and it's funny, I've heard that a lot, and I, from where I'm sitting, I don't feel like we've done anything differently, but that resonated this year, actually with the exception of like incorporating everyday folks into open announcements and driving that message home. But I'm glad that it's resonating with people, but I feel like we've always, even since before I existed in CrossFit Media, when you were there, we were still pointing the camera at the success stories and the folks who were getting their first pull-up and the folks who were losing weight.
We totally were, but back then there was only one channel. There was CrossFit.com.
That's right.
And then now there's multiple channels. Yep. CrossFit.com, CrossFitGames.com, yep. CrossFitAffiliates.com. Like, there's all kinds of different channels. And yep. I think across the board what happened when the channel separated was CrossFit.com still focused on what it always been focusing on.
Yes.
But then also would occasionally sprinkle in a bunch of game stuff.
Sure.
Whereas CrossFit Games became only the CrossFit Games.
Yeah.
And didn't highlight the other aspects of the community.
Well, or you've just got such an interesting bleed over, right? Like, there is no CrossFit Games without CrossFit, no matter what. Like, all these, most 90% of the athletes are affiliate owners or participate in, holy God.
Just going for it.
Just walk with your head down, don't worry. Don't need a crosswalk. Good Lord. Okay, have a nice day. But there's an amazing bleed over. You can't have one without the other, you know. So, and even the Open's a great example. 320,000 people signed up. 80 of those were CrossFit Games athletes.
Right.
So 0.0001% were actually Games athletes or the outrageous, amazing athletes. The rest of us were just doing it to do it, you know. Right. There's the literally people doing it without limbs. You got you've got people who are losing tremendous amounts of weights. There's beating depression, whatever the case may be. And so those stories are there in huge numbers, in hundreds of thousands of people.
Right.
But it's good that it resonates. I heard that multiple times. Hey, it looks like you guys really changed your focus. I'll be honest, there wasn't like a, hey, let's get together and change the focus of the CrossFit Games. But if we're doing a better job of it, then that still makes my heart happy.
Do you have any nicknames we should know about?
Just variations of the one. So row, the occasional roar. You know, it's typically a, I found that girls typically gravitate towards that one, but really row, straight and easy, you know?
And then how do we know each other?
Oh, wow. You know what I thought about today? We met, you won't remember this. We met at the 2008 Games after you took fourth place. Yeah, I left. And it was my first time. I was a fanboy. Actually, that's not even fair to say. I was early in my coaching career. I came to the CrossFit Games on a whim because I saw it on the website, and I was like, oh, that sounds cool. Came to the Games. You did fantastically. And then afterwards, remember they set up some like parkour stuff on the competition floor?
I do.
And we were doing parkour vaulting. And I was like, oh, hey, what's up, man? You know, I'm Rory, blah, blah, blah. And you just done fourth, and you're like, whatever, man. Nice to meet you. And you're super nice. No, you're really nice. You're really nice, but I mean... Okay.
I was overwhelmed.
Yeah, you know, and I know the feeling now. Like, you meet a lot of people, right? Like, there's, when you're you're sort of the star of the show, like, you just sort of, like, everybody shakes your hand, right? You probably met a lot of people that day, so we didn't really get into it deeply. But then I got onto the seminar staff, and I'll never forget, my first time working a gig with you and Joe Lee was late 2008, early 2009, maybe? Mm-hmm. Must have been 08. And at one point, we were going to do like a lunchtime workout or something, and we worked on a day one, and then on day two, she was like, oh yeah, hey, Rory's legit, and you were like, dude, he is legit, and I'll never forget, like, the pump of the chest. I was like, yeah, Pat thinks I'm legit. I'm good at this shit. It actually was when I was still good at CrossFit, and so we know each other through that initially. I moved to Santa Cruz when you moved away to follow a girl down to New Zealand, which, as we all know, these years later turned into your wife and the mother of your children.
Yes.
And now we know each other as dads and friends and colleagues in multiple ventures, and that's the 5-minute version. But
yeah,
once upon a time we met.
At the CrossFit Games 2000.
And we probably worked, I don't know, a handful of seminars before my tenure in that.
The first one we did, was that the one down in San Diego? At the,
USD.
USD, yep. Awesome. And Rory ended up taking the exact job that I had at HQ. So there was a point in time where I was working for Tony Budding. And we were, the entire media department was me and Tony. It was great. And I was like...
Your English teacher.
My old English teacher, yep. And I was like, hey, Tony. One day I woke up and I was like, I never want to be you. And I said those words to him because the guy was, I mean, he's a workaholic. I love him, but he loves to work. And he worked so much and so often. And I was like, I never want to be you. And he's like, well, let's find someone to take your position. And
I love Tony too, but I didn't want to be Tony.
I know. But like,
that's the one thing you didn't tell me. You're like, here's how you edit video. Here's whatever.
You're gonna be Tony.
Sucker.
The only direction out is through Tony. Right.
Sucker. And so you taught me literally in Tony's living room, or spare bedroom, or whatever that room was in his old house, how to do basic edits. The first video I ever made was Annie Thor's daughter on the Say It Back Sprint. No, that's not true. It was like Greg in Phoenix talking about what is CrossFit. Right. So. Edited a CrossFit lecture, which means I basically just beef or blade, cut.
That's edited,
drag.
Baby. That's still my version of editing.
Blade. And that was that. Yeah. You went off and did your thing.
Yeah. Awesome. All right. These are now from the community. Why don't you read? Let's start from the top down.
From the community.
And from the community, we reached out. We said, hey, give us some shits.
Okay. Cool. Number one, what advice do you give members who are wanting to try a competition? With so many competitions being held, are you sometimes cautious about encouraging people to compete? What do I tell people? I tell them that it's absolutely... There's a million angles to this question, so let's just assume that we are reducing this down to people who I assume to know the basic movements of CrossFit, have some competence, and have a good, if not great, coach to kind of guide them through the process.
Define for me competence in, like, movement.
They have been taught the movements. They perform the mechanics consistently good.
Yes.
And they've been dosed with a little bit of intensity, because that's ultimately what competition, in my opinion, is going to bring to the table, is kind of finding a next gear, so to speak.
Gotcha.
And I think there's also degrees of competition. So a local affiliate competition, Ivan is a perfect example. He's one of the guys who's been training at CrossFit HQ under Jenny. And He's lost on the order of like 150 pounds so far. So
that's an entire human.
He's not trying to. Yes, it literally is an entire human. He's not trying to go to the CrossFit Games. He wants to be a police officer. And for him, the competition was a hugely supportive and encouraging experience, you know, so in a time where you're kind of in the doldrums. So what do I tell people? I, assuming these things that I've mentioned, someone who's got a good grasp of CrossFit, I make sure that they know that they're trying to get out of the competition. So when I do the open, I know that I'm not trying to qualify for the CrossFit Games, but I am trying to beat scores that I didn't have last year. There's certain people that I want to benchmark myself against from past times, and those are the goals that I try and measure against. If you're going in with unrealistic goals, then I think it's a terrible, maybe the worst thing you could do. But 90% of the time, I'd say if the parameters are correct, I encourage people to do competition. I think it's good and healthy.
Gotcha. You just give them a good frame of reference of what the competition means. Tell them what you feel like they should get out of it, or ask them what they think they're going to get out of it, and make them set a realistic goal.
Totally. And because I think people surprise themselves.
Yeah.
Right? You can get into a funk of going through the motions. And you get into an environment where either the team series is a good example of your team depending on you, and you go a little bit faster, you do a little bit better than you thought you could, try something you wouldn't have otherwise tried in your day-to-day WOD. Mm-hmm. Or the open, where you're accountable to a leaderboard, or even better yet, like your local competition or one of these other ones where there's a little bit of a crowd, and that's maybe for a better athlete, but you know, it brings out the athlete in you.
No, I think even for someone who's not a better athlete, who's not doing best, still brings more out of them than they ever could have imagined.
Right.
I think something about a lot of people who join CrossFit have never competed in anything. So like you think about it, you put them on that stage and they're like, might as well do it. There's a bunch of other people who've never done stuff. Why don't I do it?
Right.
And I asked that question, similar to me, but I asked that question, a question in my classes the other day. I was like, how many here have thrown up ever after a workout? Like one person put up their hand. I was like, not saying you should throw up after your workouts, guys, but I urge you all to at some point in time go so hard that you vomit, just so you know.
Harder than you want to go.
Right. And I think competition, a lot of ways, it doesn't need to be vomit necessarily, but I think competition, a lot of ways, brings that out of people who've never done that before.
Yeah.
And they really see how they're, like, in the middle of a workout, they're not going to die.
Right.
They're so far from it.
Right.
And they may have never even pushed that far. So I urge competition. I just make sure people understand, like you said, realistic goals. And
not about vomiting, but about taking it to the next level.
Exactly.
And, yeah, I mean, it's like we know that's where all the good stuff lies. And if, there's got to be something that takes you out of your day-to-day training. And it steps it up to the next level.
Right.
Cool. All right.
Next one.
What do you think is the biggest positive of the CrossFit Games? The biggest positive, I think, of the CrossFit Games is getting the word out to people who would otherwise have no concept or association with the name CrossFit. So it's really, for better or worse, it's our largest outward facing effort that we do in a year.
Yeah.
Millions of people will see the shows that we put out on ESPN, and the messaging, hopefully, that we talked about earlier will be drawn within. And my great hope is that it induces enough curiosity for someone at home to either say, hey, wow, I'm actually a competitive athlete and I'd like to try to compete, or more importantly, hey, you know what? That stuff looks cool. That community looks healthy. I'd like to get a piece of that, and I want to see what it's all about. And they walk into an affiliate in their local town or state.
Yeah.
And I truly believe it's all anecdotal. I haven't done a survey, and I don't have anything to back this up, but I truly think that's happening. I think that affiliates are feeling a surge whenever the CrossFit Games are put out on television. So that's the greatest benefit that I see to it. And I also see it as, you know, yesterday I was at the ranch, and it holds a huge, really important place in my heart, because back then it really was, you know, the first time I went, it was just this awe-inspiring weird thing. Second year I went, it was like homecoming, and saw a bunch of people I'd met the year before, and it was like-minded people. We talked about things CrossFit. I asked them about problems with my affiliate. They provided potential solutions. It's just a cool gathering of like-minded people, really the hardest of the hardcore coming together. It's an awesome, awesome festival of fitness.
Yeah, I think one thing too to know is, like, I listened to a podcast and I was talking about the responsibility of a company who runs a franchise model, and then the responsibility of a company who runs a licensee model. Uh-huh. And so CrossFit being a licensee model, the responsibility that the main company has is very different than a franchise model. So in a franchise model, the people who buy into a franchise, they buy in at a really high premium. They're millions of dollars deep or whatever it may be. Like, and they're basically, they become people who count straws. Like, they're making sure that everything's done exactly to a book, how everything's done. And that's been set up by the franchisor, right? Whereas the difference in a licensee model is the responsibility that the main company has to the people who license is brand recognition. And if you think about brand recognition in the world of fitness, in the world of the world, the CrossFit Games is the number one way to get the brand recognized. So, like, even if someone in the middle of Norway says the word CrossFit, they have an idea, just an idea, even if it's like not a very extreme version of what CrossFit is, when being the CrossFit Games, they have an idea of what CrossFit is. It gives a person who's a licensee the ability to speak about it. Without having any previous definition.
That's right.
Which I think the CrossFit Games does a phenomenal job of, because even though it is an extreme version of it, it gets it out there in such a huge way. So that, to me, is like the biggest, exactly what you said, the biggest positive.
It also really pulls the carpet out underneath from underneath the people who are, for lack of a better word, infringing on our copyrights and opening up gyms that are clearly CrossFit but are saying that there's something else. And by owning that space, I mean, the CrossFit Games are the world's premier test to find the fittest on earth, right? But in so doing, it's also, people recognize that. And they know, you know, it is the gold standard, and people know and recognize that. And so when someone says, no, this is this is Pat Fit, it's like, no, you're full of shit. Because I've been watching this thing for 6 years on television, and I know the concepts underlying it because I'm a fan of the sport, or because I was a fan of the sport, which made me get interested in getting into a gym. So in that way, hopefully also protects affiliate owners as well.
No, I like that. I never even thought of it that way. But it makes a huge... I mean, the second someone comes out and says, like, we're doing Billy Fit. And we win the CrossFit Games, and you're like, ah.
Right. In unrelated news completely, check out rowfit.com.
R-O-W or R-O-E, like the
just
fish?
Just R-O, capital R-O,
gotcha,
bro.
Gotcha, all right.
It's CrossFit without the C S S F I T.
It's with a K.
All right. How does HQ decide which athletes to follow or promote? It's an interesting question. There's really nothing conspiratorial or that rocket science about it on either of the extremes. the athletes who compete in the CrossFit Games clearly get a ton of coverage. We, as you'll see if this comes out before the fall ESPN shows, there's a tremendous amount of work that goes into backstage coverage. And, you know, people naturally gravitate towards someone with a big personality, towards people who are putting out content that's naturally fun to watch or impressive, you know. So stupid human tricks and what I even include in that, like, amazing athletic performances. Like, if I see somebody snatch 315 pounds like Elijah Muhammad did the other day, it's really hard to ignore. If I see someone doing...
Are you guys doing some stories on Elijah Muhammad?
No.
Oh.
No, but I guess the question is follow or promote. So I guess I can speak for myself. You should have Jonathan Haynes on your show to talk about CrossFit Games social media. But people are naturally gravitated towards, and maybe you can clarify what maybe the question is if I'm not answering it.
No, you are. You
but, yeah, there's no, we don't sit down and say, hey, this year we're going to follow so-and-so and such, with the exception of in the years that there's been documentary films, and you can imagine how hard this is. You definitely look at, like, who are the key players going to be this year, right?
Seems like it's athletic performance.
Yeah.
Like, just obvious athletic talent, and then, like, entertainment value through, like, seeing that they're a good person, they present themselves well in the public.
Or just the story, right? Like, what was the story in the men's competition this year? Could Matt Fraser stop being the perennial second? Could Ben Smith back up his first place? In the women's competition, we had this conglomeration, and so the temptation is to go and cover people that you expect to do well, like Sam Briggs early season, but who could have foreseen that Sam Briggs may have a potential U.S. immigration issue, right? So you try and cover all these people early in the season, and the recipe is kind of become clear that You cover the big names as best you can, but you can't bank on anything. Right. You know, we invested a lot of time, and Levered Death is bad luck. She got back eventually, but the year that Stacey Tovar failed to qualify for the games,
right.
You know, we had invested a lot of time and effort into her story. And that's not always a bad thing. This year, I thought it was a really interesting Road to the Games episode when Brooke Entz did not qualify.
Yeah.
Because you see the human emotion. And
there's always stories.
There's always stories there. So I don't know. That's vagaries, but I think, you know, we do our best to tell the stories that we think are the most relevant to the community, in my opinion. And then what I like, and I know that you like too, is I love humor. I like the funny side of things.
Right.
So for me personally, I can say, like, athletes with the biggest personalities, I tend to gravitate myself towards. Or there just are some athletes who you naturally are sort of pulled towards more than others, and that just happens. You know, I'm a LeBron James fan, and I'm a Golden State Warriors fan, but Steph Curry is less exciting for me than LeBron James, just personality-wise, you know?
Fair enough.
I can't tell you why exactly with tangible things to back it up, it is how it is.
Right. Okay. Cool.
What is one personal CrossFit regret you have, if any? I tremendously regret not doing the last chance qualifier in 2009. I was...
Oh, really?
Yep. I was 12th at the SoCal Regional that year. I bombed the first workout. Bombed it. Like, literally went to the medical tent afterwards and thought that I had something crazy. You shouldn't have done the last two workouts, but on workouts 2 and 3, there's only 3 workouts.
Yep.
I got 5th and 2nd respectively. And I could have freaking gone to the CrossFit Games in 2009. And if I had, I wonder what the rest of my CrossFit, you know, athletic life would have looked like. But, you know, wishing is for suckers. Dave Castro was with me when they released the last chance qualifiers. And he was like, oh, are you going to do them? And I'll never forget this. I was at Jordan's gym and I cracked a beer and drank it and said, no.
And that was the regret.
And that's well, if it's one CrossFit regret, like that's it.
I had a feeling that that it was gonna be that
performance related.
Well, that was gonna be that. You and I have talked about a similar that time. I get that. I don't know if I have any. I kind of did everything I wanted to do.
Nothing like in the competition. Nothing like
in competition. I've been so lucky. Like, okay, I guess my biggest is not facing or knowing where Marcus Philly was the year that I didn't qualify. Because I didn't know.
Oh, yeah, it's
so
a good one.
The year that I didn't qualify, when I ran back to the bar, I didn't realize how far ahead of him I was. And when I went for that last clean and I got squirted out, had like a 2 or 3 second pause.
Yeah.
And I just went for it because I didn't know. Because he was behind me, and then I saw the footage of it afterwards, which I'd love to track down, by the way, if you...
Oh, yeah, let's find that.
And he's literally, like, I could have waited that time, made that one clean, and I would have gone to the games that year. Because then it was Neil ran in, Garrett ran in, and then he went in. And if I would have just stood that clean up, it would have been me, then Neil, Garrett, him. And it would have put me in the games. And it's like, that moment plays over my head of, like, take the breath, Pat. And because I never do that. I never miss, like,
in
competition or in anywhere. Like, I don't miss reps because I know what I'm doing.
Yeah.
And it was just that 1 second too long of, like, dun, dun, boom, or too short of a rest. And yeah, so I regret
that. That's a good one. That's a really good one.
Yeah, because that was the year that killed my confidence for years now. I've had a lack of confidence as an athlete. That and being around Jason, who, like, it was never good enough when you were training with him. It's like, why didn't you do that? I'm like, because I weigh 50 pounds less than you asshole. And like, I can say
because it's
that,
the Husafeld stuff, right? Jason, no one can lift it.
Yeah, well, so in my head I know, like, I say the words like, because I'm 50 pounds less than you, bro, but then I still psychologically take it on board of, like, I'm not good enough.
Yeah.
And so since then I've always been in my head, I'm not good enough as an athlete, when I actually don't think that's true.
Yeah.
I think I am good enough as an athlete. But I just have never had that confidence again. Anyway, that's my biggest
one. I like, that's a good one. That's a really good memory. I mean, not good in, like, not good.
I really
in a good
like
way.
Looking back on that and laughing at you. That's what I really like.
No, that's it's a great analysis by an athlete. You know, like, that's I wouldn't have thought of that one. I would have gone straight to the games. But yeah, shit. I mean, that was a huge moment for you.
It was. But I've got tons of amazing things. I'm sure, like, you do as well.
Yeah.
That have come since then. That
right.
Supersede any of that.
Do you focus on being funny or entertaining as much as you do on coaching quality during each class? Well, I guess I should say first and foremost that I am not coaching on a regular basis. I'm getting back to coaching on a regular basis, but I've been...
But you were a great coach when you were coaching often. I you run love gyms coaching. And you've done level yes. ones for years.
Love coaching. So I... And you know what? I could even say this for my current job, too. I work very hard to make it look like I don't have to work hard. And I would do that with coaching too. So I would show up as early as I possibly could to ensure that I knew exactly how the class was set up. I'd usually put equipment out in advance and know who was coming to the class so that if I could inject humor, then I would. But I would say that when I was on seminar staff, not in my application of coaching, like, but in lecturing for sure, there's a directive which is educate first, inspire second, and then entertain third. So educate, inspire, entertain. And I would sometimes move entertainment to the front, like especially if I was lecturing, you know, like lead with a joke
this question's a funny one to be asked to you and I.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And I got that feedback, and I don't know if you have, but oftentimes like, hey man, like why don't you make sure that you don't forget to lecture on the hip movement before you throw a joke in there.
Right.
And it was actually really fair. It was one of the best things that ever happened to me, probably.
I would say that's unique to lecturing, though. Because lecturing, there's a standard that you're going to hit, right?
Yeah.
When I coach classes, I think, I mean, what's the spoonful of medicine, or spoonful of...
Sugar.
Sugar makes the medicine go down. It's like, a lot of that information that we're giving people and how they need to hear it, like, how they're hearing it is just as important as that they're hearing it. So, like...
Yeah.
And I think it's situational where... But if you're looking to play to a larger audience, I'd say more people can understand and listen through humor.
Yes.
Than people listen through a straight-off thing.
Come on. Yeah, absolutely.
So if we're looking to play to majority, like a majority rules sort of deal, I would say instill humor as your basic style.
Yeah.
And then you can tailor not being funny to people who need you to not be funny.
That's right.
Whereas if you flip that and you focus on just content... for a class setting, you're actually going to play to a smaller demographic when it comes to people coming into your classes.
Oh, yeah. Would you rather go to a more fun coach who's less
technically
proficient? You know, but not proficient, maybe, but, like, focused? Or someone who's just an absolute technician with, like, just this is the most serious thing we've ever done?
Right.
Especially if you're paying $150 a month or, you know, whatever your affiliate dues are.
Yep.
Yeah, I want to enjoy that hour of time that I'm spending with my life. So,
well, I think there's... perfect examples of that out there.
Yeah.
Like, if you looked at when the original gyms were, like, some of the first gyms, like, you look at the difference between, like, Jason Kalipa's original gym and other gyms. He was literally that guy. He was, like, less technically proficient, but very fun to be around.
Yeah.
And everyone was, and his gym, like, I always, you know, to be honest, I expected his gyms to fail.
Right.
And I'd come back and I'd be like, hey, dude, how's your gyms doing? And he'd be like, oh, you know, we're doing pretty good, like 400 members. And that was at the time where gyms had like, you know, maybe
good,
70
yeah.
members,
yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
And he's like, yeah, 400, 450. And I'm like, what? Blah, blah, blah. You know, like, I didn't see that.
So, around the same time that, like, the keep your bathroom clean and you'll get good clients video came out, and you go to Jason's Santa Clara thing, and you're like, oh, my God.
There's poop on the walls.
There's a dead body in here.
Sorry, but...
Yeah, against all odds, man. Yeah, he's just... exactly. So a magnetic personality will draw people in, and no doubt about it, so...
But I think that now in the landscape of the CrossFit community, you have to offer the other side, too. Because now there's so many gyms that we need to be... You know, you create this community and this environment around fun and enjoying and, like, bringing barriers down, but then you need to be able to dish out and give them the highest quality... technical coaching.
Yes.
In that manner.
Yes.
So.
And even, you know, I'm more sensitive to it now. Like, I think that the biggest credential or characteristic of a coach that you would want and find desirable is empathy and the ability to kind of understand and feel what their clients are feeling. And I think that when you're young, it's a harder time. And I'll never forget this. When I was coaching at US CrossFit, I was 2 years deep, and I've been working with this one individual for... maybe those full 2 years, and he was 65 years old. I think he had a spinal fusion. He had, he was an older dude, and but he wasn't decrepit. He would still get through wads, and he would move decently well. And one time, he took me aside, and it had been years, so it hit me hard. And he was like, "Hey, man, I love you, but you got to understand, like, I have injuries that are older than you. Like, you are this 26-year-old, and I love your passion, and you got lots of energy, and you really fire me up, but you got to be more sensitive to the fact that, like, people don't feel the way that you feel inside. Like, my bones fucking hurt, man. Yeah. And so I'm only 35 years old, but now I've torn my ACL, I've got kids, you know, my life circumstances are different to where I can associate with somebody, and I'm like, you walk in late from dropping your kids off to my 9 a.m. class, and I'm not going to make you do burpees. I can feel what you're feeling. I'm kind of going down a different road with that. But
no,
like,
no, that's exactly the... That's perfect.
You can associate with with different people in different ways, so...
That's funny that you say that empathy. I mean, I've come full... Not full circle, but I've coached for a long time, too. And I've been immature for years, but I've been trying to put my finger on the single greatest thing I'd ever want from a coach. And the word that I used was emotional intelligence.
Yeah, that's perfect.
Is like, I want somebody to have a strong level of emotional intelligence and the ability to feel where somebody's at.
Let's do a Glen Canyon lab.
And give them what they need.
Okay.
And whether they, I mean, and that, I think that plays to every, exactly as you're saying. Like, you need to be able to look at a class or go up to somebody and really feel where they're at. Like,
yeah.
And be like, does this person need to be yelled at or does this person need to be coddled?
Right.
And that... That is a unique thing, and that has to develop over time, and that develops through your own life experiences and all those other pieces. But I stand behind the fact that if I'm looking for anything in a coach, it's their emotional intelligence.
Yep, and yeah, no matter what you call it, both of those two things that we said, they're more or less the same thing. But you can't teach them. It's a character
trait.
Actually. You think so?
Well, yes and no. So here's the deal.
I guess I would just tell people, like, if you want to be a coach, just because you want to be. You should make sure that you are good at connecting with people.
Yes.
I feel like it's hard. You convince me that you can teach that because I feel like it's unteachable.
No, so, okay, so here's what made me think you can teach it, right? If you put it in terms of emotional intelligence and the ability to feel the nuance of emotion, right?
Sure.
Like, in any given situation. Uh-huh. We all have different abilities in this. Some people higher, some people lower.
Yeah.
Some people naturally have a higher amount. Now, there's people who exist whose brains don't fire in a way that they feel any, like, any emotional intelligence. They cannot feel a room. And those are the people where you're talking to them and you're like, this is weird. Like, why did you say that way? Or why? And, like, the coach that you go into their class and you sit there and you're watching the class and you're like, do you not feel what's happening right now? And the thing is, I think a lot of people truly can't.
Right.
But I believe it's a spectrum. It's not like a black and white. And I think simply by showing people that this thing called emotional intelligence exists, they start to become more reflective upon themselves and pay attention more closely to the nuance of situations. And not like someone's facial structure or whatever it may be, but they pay attention to the after effect of a situation that they're in, and they reflect on it and they go, okay, what happened there? Why did that happen there? Could it have been something with how I dealt with this situation?
Yeah.
Now I can go move forward and maybe learn some of it. Now, I don't know all the details of talking about emotional intelligence. It's actually something I'm reading up on, because I feel like if you could teach how to elevate someone's emotional intelligence, it's going to impact every level of their coaching.
Yeah.
So I'm reading up on it and doing some podcast stuff where I listen to podcasts on it and trying to figure it out. But
to your point about hiring people, though, I would say that that's something that would, as you say, like, that's the high, you put the highest premium on that.
Yep.
So the top candidates are going to come to the table with it.
100%.
Yeah. And the androids, like, from Star Trek, who literally don't understand what you mean by funny, you know, like,
right.
It's just, they're not even going to be on the table for consideration.
Right. That was a really long answer that went way out of.
I like it though. That could be a standalone show.
It could.
What would be your recommendation for new coaches? What are the best ways to get started? How does one look for a coaching position, or solicit mentoring? Well, the last part of the question, solicit mentoring, is exactly what I would recommend for new coaches. So, coaches got to coach, man. Deadlifters got to deadlift. You're gonna suck at doing it until you've done it a few times. Regardless of the amount of content that you've read, regardless how many videos you watch, until you actually take the empathetic approach and interact with other human beings and try and get them into the positions, both verbally and physically, that you're trying to achieve, you're never going to get better at it. So you got a coach. How do you solicit a mentor? I'll tell you how I did it. And the world was different a little bit back then in Southern California when I was at US CrossFit, but I reached out to as many people as I possibly could. You'd be amazed how many people, even higher up in the CrossFit HQ organization, someone like Pat, are really accessible. I've got about, on a standing basis, I only let about 23 emails stay unread, and that's more or less a to-do list. So, and I know most people that I interact with are the same way. So, in my early days, Stefan Roche, CJ Martin, they were all locals in the area, and they were tremendously helpful. Just literally opened up their brains and poured out anything, both by phone calls and emails, and gave me tons and tons of information. So just find someone you respect. Find someone who you think is a fantastic coach and ask them, could I shadow you? Hopefully you have the opportunity to make it happen without pay. So, you know, tell them that you'll shadow them for free or whatever the case may be. But find a good coach. You know, watching the best at their craft is the only way that you're going to hone yours.
Yeah. And then trying to mimic it.
Yeah. And then coach. I found a lot of success coaching beginners early on in my CrossFit career. Not only because they're less refined, but also, because they're less refined for two reasons. One, because so are you, and two, because they're going to actually have faults that you've got to correct. Right. You know, one of the most frustrating things in the world for a starting coach is an athlete who's pretty freaking good and just needs to fine-tune things. I think they need a coach with a lot of experience who's going to recognize the nuance and take them where they want to go. Beginners are more of an open book. And having said that, make sure you're not just trying to drop the throttle on them. But, yeah, that's where I would start. Those are always my key recommendations. Know your skill level. Yeah, ask for help from someone you respect. Practice all the time. And work with beginners.
And be okay with sucking.
Be okay with sucking, yeah.
And like, not be offended when someone says you suck.
You have to suck.
You have to suck. I think it's totally okay. And not like you want to suck. You don't go with the intention of sucking.
Right.
I mean, unless that's your thing.
This guy has no idea you're behind him.
It's okay.
Nope, no idea.
We got
he didn't even want to smile. He wanted to be like, "What, bitch? What, you want to hit me?
What, you gonna hit me?" But then always just listen to the people around you, take advice on board, and just always want to get better. I like it.
Yeah, and there's endless video content online now from fantastic coaches doing good stuff. Like, the educational tools, like the online stuff that I'm really proud of, the anatomy class that they put out. It's fantastic. Yeah, there's a million different things. And even like the traveling seminars, not just our specialty courses, but there's, DeWitt, man, he's hosting people for movement stuff.
Oh, yeah.
You can find things if you're looking. So keep looking.
Like, if there's one piece of advice you could give to someone getting into the competitive game now, what would it be? Just one. You get one thing to say to them, one little sentence like, hey, they're getting into the competitive game. They want to go to the CrossFit Games.
I guess this is what I do with a lot of things. And I'm not saying this is the right approach or not, but find someone who's done it, who you can have access to, and have them try and talk you out of it. If you still think you want to do it, you'll have a much better idea of what it's going to take. And you'll be a little bit more in touch with reality.
That's great.
Does that make sense?
Oh, that makes tons of sense.
So many people think they're going to walk through the doors of a gym because they're a good athlete.
No.
And go
great.
To the CrossFit Games.
That's good stuff. I like that.
Make them talk you out of it.
Oh, yeah.
Pat'll do it.
Oh, I will talk you out of it.
And tell them how easy it is to make it to the CrossFit Games, Pat.
I will tell. Oh, man. I'm excited too.
Old Val Voberil, she can go on an hour a day maybe, but I think it takes more than that.
Oh man. Okay, yeah. I'm in. That's a good thing. I like. You know what? We can end it there.
Love you, buddy. This was fun, man.
It was.
Got to surf. We got to have a great conversation.
Yes, sir.
Are you coming in?
Yeah, might as well.